Jumping into a little bit about authentic materials, and I think this kind of ties in a little bit with scaffolding, but it's, we want to try to really push to use those authentic materials, but it can be really challenging. I personally teach primarily level one, and so it can definitely be challenging to use those authentic materials, especially where students maybe don't have any background or knowledge. So non-heritage speakers, they're just coming in, they've never seen Russian before, and they're not sure what to do with it. How do you effectively use those authentic materials when students really don't have any background or connections to anything that you're putting in front of them? Shannon, we'll start with you, please.
So one of the ways is to choose them wisely. I think we all understand that to a certain extent, any text can be for any level as long as the task goes along with the right level. But on the other hand, we also don't want to make our students feel completely intimidated. And so, choosing our texts wisely can be helpful. So an example is one of the things that I'm always looking for is infographics for lower level students, because they're so useful in that they incorporate visuals, they incorporate icons, they incorporate charts and numbers, things that students can understand. And so, I think, that's one example of a type of text that can be very approachable for students on lower levels. I already mentioned the idea of kind of embedding scaffolding into things like videos or texts. And then I just wanted to mention one other thing that I've done with my students on the lower levels, which is I created a set of scenarios. And I may be stretching the definition of authentic materials a little bit here, but the scenarios, what I did with them was I took what students were learning in a particular unit, and then I imagined what could we do to have them put themselves in a real life situation with these things. So I'll give an example of that in the very, very early parts of first semester. I have my students do a scenario where they're pretending to work in a clothing store. So the things that they need to do to be able to do this scenario are they need to understand numbers up to a certain, I forget how many, but up to a certain point. They need to understand words for clothing, and they need to understand, I think it was colors. And then they had to have some like politeness phrases, like please and thank you, those kinds of things. And so I created a scenario where they were pretending to work in a clothing store. The first thing that happens in the clothing store is that they receive boxes of clothes that they have to put in the right section of the store. It's pretty simple. It's just kind of a matching, right? But I'm hoping that it makes them imagine how they could really use these skills. Then they have to open the boxes and check how many shirts they've received compared to how many they were supposed to receive. And of course, the order is not quite correct. And so then after they've done that, on the next page, they have to write an email, quote unquote, to their manager of their store. And of course, at this point, they're really not a high enough level to write their own email, but what I do is I provide an email, and then they have to kind of drag and drop things into different places in the email. So they have to understand enough to say, something like, we were supposed to get 4 pairs of pants and we only got three, or something like that, and put that into the email. And so it at least gives them the feeling of that they did something using the target language, and it also sort of introduces them to the interface of like an email, even though they're not writing it themselves yet. And so these scenarios, I'm using sort of semi-authentic materials, like materials that are based on authentic materials, and then trying to put it together into a scenario where I'm hoping that at least they feel that they can imagine themselves in that real life situation.
I really love that. I love just it's an everyday life thing that especially a student maybe studying abroad might want to seek employment, and maybe something like a clothing store, this is truly an opportunity for them to practice and potentially make those connections. I absolutely love that. Thank you so much for that. Excellent. And then Heather, same question. So how can teachers effectively use those authentic materials in the level one classroom, especially in situations where students don't have any background or connections with the language just yet?
So especially at the lower levels, kind of like I was saying before, like I really like to stick with what's familiar to the students, you know, sticking with what's authentic, but what's going to be familiar to provide that sort of scaffolding and that comfort and familiarity. So, I mean, this can be, you know, YouTube videos in Russian and exploring the comment section if provided. A lot of people in the comment section will use emojis, you know, and this kind of provides a sort of scaffolding for students. They'll understand just by the visual what must be, you know, what the message might be. You know, they can use that as kind of a crutch, as for understanding, for decoding the language. We go to shopping sites, like there's ozone.ru, which is kind of like an Amazon shopping site. And just by using, so the students can rely so much on the visuals to learn the language, to learn about pricing and the currency values in Russian. You know, and they can go to similar sites like in Russia and in the post-Soviet country. So it doesn't have to just be Russian sites, but Russian language sites like in Kazakhstan or Uzbekistan or Latvia, if they exist, which they might not, or Georgia, et cetera. Transportation schedules online, airport information online. All of these things are, you know, sites we use on an everyday basis and that we're familiar with, but they just are in Russian. So this is really where I like to start. And also at the beginning, especially for those students who are really brave and especially online, I encourage students to translate their lives, I say, into Russian, to change their settings on their phone or on Google into Russian language, so that everything that they see in Gmail or on their phone, all of their apps are in Russian, you know, if they just change the language. And so they can see right away these things that they're familiar with, these things that they already know, translated into Russian. And it carries a lot of meaning, you know, when it's something that you already know, it's something that you use on a daily basis, it's something that you need, all of a sudden it's in Russian. So the students can start engaging with these authentic materials in a way that's immediately meaningful for them. We use weather websites. I go to gizmoteo.ru all of the time for students. And again, they see the visuals, you know, they understand the icon of the sun or the clouds, and they immediately know what this means. You know, but at the same time, they're going to learn things using these sites like, you know, Celsius and Fahrenheit conversions and things like that, that differ between the cultures and that aren't just language specific. So again, I like to stay with the familiar, but use authentic sites and encourage that very, very, very early on.
And that definitely, I think, especially for brand new students who might be intimidated, it might help lower that effective filter, just being able to see some things like the little sun icon or maybe an emoji of a smiley face. It just gives it a little bit of context and maybe just enough to try. So excellent ideas. Really good.